So, good morning, and let's start our presentation. As you know, this is a case for the Keio University Global Research Institute sponsored this lecture, and KGRI aims to promote international research and educational exchange and invite those who are working on the front of the research and education in Japan and overseas to give lectures. So this time we have two presenters, and the first one is Professor Takis Machiopoulos. He is a professor at the Department of Informatics and Telecommunications, University of Athens, Greece. And also he's a professor of the, before he was a professor of the British Columbia. Okay. And just very brief explanation about him. I met him when I was very, very young. We are more than 30 years good friends. When I finished my PhD, when I was 27 years old, I went to Canada to stay 2 years at the postdoc, University of Ottawa in Canada. At that time, he was a PhD student. Okay? We are on the same age. Okay? So we are now 61 years old together. And since then, our research area is very similar. We work together, and also we met many, many times in the conferences. So in his case, after he got the PhD, he moved to Vancouver, and he became the full professor at the British Columbia. That is one of the best universities in Canada. But he wanted to return, because his original country was Greece. So that is why he's very strong at mathematics. Okay? Anyway, he wanted to return to Greece, so he found a position at the director of the observatory, the research institute of the observatory in Athens. Then, after that, he moved to the full professor at the University of Athens. So this time, actually this is the second time for him to come to our university, and also Kentaro Toyoda, he also got a PhD under the guidance of the Takis. So we are very proud of this time. And this time, he took two nieces over there, so they are very happy. Okay, so let's start. Okay. And the presentation title is like this one, Communications Over Fading Channels, Past and Present and Future. Okay, please.
Minasan o hayo gozaimasu. I had to write it. I remember it, but I might forget it. So, well, hello, everybody. I'm very pleased to be here, pleased and honored. I always enjoy my stay here, not only academically, but also personally, and I feel at home here, despite the difficulties in the language, the difficulties for me, because I can't speak Japanese, but nevertheless, I know my way now around, I would like to thank Professor Sarase and his students and his colleagues for making me feel at home. Today, my talk is about, just 1 second, this is the pointer, okay. So my talk is about communication over fading channels. And since my country is a historical country, I will give a history. This presentation reflects also the history, my path my main path, I would say, in research. So it's the title is also it has the past, the present and the future. I will talk more about the past and the present, a little bit about the future. Okay. This is the outline of my presentation. I will first talk about the wireless propagation environment. This is where the fading comes in. When there is a movement in the transmitter or the receiver, then the signal goes up and down. So essentially, we have a fading process. So the signal is distorted, and we have to do something about it to undistort it, to remove the distortion. Then I will be talking about the different fading classifications. Third, I will be talking about the receiver structures, which improve the performance. I will be talking about diversity techniques. Then I will be talking about a class of fading channels, which we have done a lot of work, and we have been pioneering in some sense. We are the first group, my group was the first one to deal with these channels. Then I will talk about some research, future research topics. So the past is up to here, the current is this area, and the future is this area, okay? So let me go on with the first one. It's basically the fading problem. The mobile applications have been with us for many, many years. It's the last maybe 20 years that it has started a lot of research going on. But nevertheless, the problem of fading has been with us for the last 60 years, so a long time ago. We have basically two phenomena for this. We have a time variation of the channel because of the movement, and multipath. Multipath are reflections of the signal, the same signal arriving at the same point being the receiver. We can represent this if we send a pulse at a certain time period, then at the receiver we'll get these pulses. These are two reflections. And in another time instant, we have other reflections. So obviously, the signal is distorted. It's not a deterministic distortion, it's a random distortion depending upon the movement. So we need mathematical tools, probabilistic tools to model this phenomenon. Essentially, we classify these fading channels into two categories, three categories. The first one is the short-term fading. The short-term fading is the fading which changes the signal every microsecond, so continuously changing the signal. There is another phenomenon, there are another fading, the long-term fading, which is which gives us a model of how the signal is changing in the long term, like for example in seconds or in hours, and this happens in you can think it as the mean of the change. Okay, for example, this happens in satellite communication when it rains, the signal is attenuated due to the rain. So this is long term attenuation because it can last for hours. And then we have a combination of these two, which we call composite fading channels, okay? This is a graphical representation of the signals. We start with the path losses, and as I say, we have the deterministic change, and this reflects the signal attenuation, so it depends on the distance, where I have shown it there, the D. The longer D is, the more attenuation we have. And this N here is a parameter. Usually this is 2. So it attenuates with a D to the square, usually. Now we have the statistical fading, which I talked about when we have movement. And this is the long term and the short term. I will start with the short term. There are several models, the Rayleigh fading model, the Risian fading model, the Nakagami M fading model, and the Weibull. Now, all these names come from people who discovered them, okay? So you might know from physics, Lord Rayleigh, which we know from the optics, but it applies also into the radio signals, and I will explain in a minute how. Then we have the Risian fading, and this is due to Stephen Rice, who wrote a paper in 1948, a mathematical paper, and from that paper, after many, many years, we had the application of the Risian fading channel, which is a typical channel for satellite communications. And then we have the very famous Nakagami fading channel. Nakagami wrote a paper in 1960. At that time, nobody paid attention. He was a Japanese researcher, I believe, not a professor. And he wrote this paper. It's a kind of an empirical paper. He suggested a probability density function which could be used for fading channels. And he did that without, it was an ad hoc approach. And then it turned out after about 30 years that his model fits very well wideband channels. And when CDMA came into the 3G, then his model has been used extensively, and nowadays it's being used very, very many, many times. Okay. So he's very famous. In Weibull, he is not that famous, but he was also in another field. He was a professor of statistics, and he proposed this, his distribution as a means of measuring reliability. And after, again, many, many years in the late 90s, measurements have shown that his model can also be used. And my group was the first one to really deal with this fading channel model. So this is the a few words about the short-term fading. This is the Rayleigh fading. And now here, what is what we have a base station and we have a mobile user. It's a car, and the car moves. And then in order to derive the Rayleigh fading model, you have to assume that the signal is reflected. There is no direct signal from the mobile station to the car or to the mobile receiver. And you get reflections from all over the place, from more angles. So if you do that, then you get the Rayleigh fading. And the, we call it that way because the envelope is it has this probability density function, and the phase is uniformly distributed. A typical graph of the signal is shown here in this graph, in this plot. So you can see the signal goes up and down very fast and very and a lot. It varies a lot. Like we have like 30, 40, 50 dB of signal variation. These nulls here occur very, 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 very often. They occur every, if we transmit a signal with 1 GHz radio frequency, they occur every 15 centimeters. So you can imagine if we go with 50 kilometers an hour, or even if we walk, we have many of these up and downs. So the receiver has to deal with this problem. Then we have the Riesian fading channel, which is, as I said, it's typical for satellite communication. And the difference between the Riesian and the Rayleigh fading channel is that the Riesian has a direct path. So this is used for satellite, mobile satellite communication, or when you have a signal outside of the city from a base station, which is always there, and you have also the reflections. So here, the signal, the envelope is Rayleigh distributed, and the phase has this complicated expression. There is a K factor, which denotes the ratio between the powers, between the transmit signal, the direct signal, and the reflected signal. The higher this K is, the better signal we have, okay? And it turns out that if K is zero, it means that we have Rayleigh fading. Okay. Then we have the famous Nakagami fading channel. This is the expression here. It involves a gamma function. It's actually, it looks complicated. It's not that complicated. Once you begin to work with it, it's not difficult. And it's convenient because it has this exponential. So if you want to solve integrals, and you need to solve integrals in order to find performance measures, for example, then this distribution is very easy to deal with. Okay. And then we have the Weibull distribution. This is another distribution. It involves, again, an exponential. And if you have this exponential, as I say, it's easy to work with. Okay. Now, for this, it's a quite generic distribution. It becomes exponential distribution when this beta, it has this parameter beta here. When beta equals 1, it becomes an exponential distribution. If beta equals 2, it becomes a Rayleigh distribution. And if beta tends to infinity, then there is no fading, basically. So it's similar to the K factor. Here we have a beta factor. Now, if you combine different distributions, then you get the composite fading. The easiest way to explain the composite fading is that you have a direct a mean of the signal, a direct signal, and this signal is changing. Okay, so you have this short term, this long term, and short term fading, and you can have different combinations of signals. You can have the so-called log normal shadowing, this is given by this expression. The difficulty, these are more difficult models to deal with, and the difficulty is that we have a variable within the exponential inside. So this is the signal noise ratio here. So this becomes more complicated, okay, in order for us to evaluate it. And we have a combination of rise and log normal. Again, here we have a Riesian and a log normal distribution. We can have a Nakagami log normal, the combination of these two. And some more sophisticated models are shown here by the generalized kappa distribution, which is a gamma PDF plus a Nakagami distribution. So these are models which have been used and are being using. We are using them, and they denote the how we model under different applications, under different environments, the fade, the channel, basically, right? So now, after I explain what the distortions will be, now I go to the problem of how to deal with these signals, the distorted signals. And in that sense, we need to propose receivers which improve the performance. Now, what happens with a fading? I will take the simplest case of a Rayleigh fading, okay? Because this is the simplest case. This is a typical performance evaluation. It has the bit error rate, how many errors we have. We are transmitting, for example, 1 million bits. We have 10 errors, then the probability is 10 to the minus 5. And this is a signal to noise ratio here. So when we increase the signal, then the signal noise ratio, then it means we have a better channel. We have more strong signal, so the performance should be better. And indeed, as we increase signal noise ratio, the performance improves. But you can see here, when we have fading, we have this, typically we get this, what we call error floors. Error floors means that the performance remains constant, even if we improve the signal. Okay, so there is this doesn't help if we increase the signal, so increase the power. So we have to find other means of removing these error floors. Now, this I hope this is correct what I wrote. Sorry, I don't remember it, but I have I would say that with my Greek accent. Watasi vasore o higiu ni oku no ga. Suki. I like it very much, I understand. This is, and why do I like it very much? Because it's a difficult problem to solve. Most probably if fading wasn't in existence, then I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't become a professor. I wouldn't be here to talk about it. And I wouldn't be as excited as I am. And I am for the last many, many years. So we need to find appropriate receiver structures. Going back to the how the signal is distorted, it's distorted in two ways. It's distorted in the amplitude. Remember I showed you the signal which goes up and down. But also it's distorted in the phase. Remember I told you that for the Rayleigh fading channel, the phase is uniformly distributed. So in other words, once we have this fading model, we don't know the phase of the signal. The phase of the signal can go anywhere. It's uniformly distributed from 0 to 2 pi. So this is the biggest problem than the amplitude. And when we started working on this, And that's about almost 30 years ago, a little bit less than 30 years ago. That will explain the history behind it. Then what happened is that the first papers, they ignored the face, okay? And they somehow, you know, in some papers, they look nice, but they make some assumptions which are not easy to detect, especially if something is, if the field is new. So the old papers, before we started working on this subject, they assumed that the face somehow can be detected, but this is not true. It's not easy to do that. It can be, but doesn't. So I started working on this topic, not for fading channels, but for a carrier face, which is something similar. And this is part of my PhD. And Professor Sasase was a kind examiner, so he allowed me to to continue my studies, one of the examiners. So anyways, I had this, we proposed, in order for us to estimate this, the amplitude and the phase, one way to do that is to transmit pilotones. And with the pilotones are steady signals, known signals, with which change in amplitude and phase with the same as the signal. So in that sense, we can remove the distortion of the signal. So this was one of the first techniques which has been used. It's a dual pilot tone. This is a QAM signal, any signal, and then you extract these pilot tones and you frequency divide by two, you get the two omega C, this is the carrier frequency, and then you get the whatever distortion is on the pilots is on the signal too, so you can remove it. So this is something which I start working for about a year, and these are the mathematics. It's quite easy to. This is what you get essentially. This is the phase of the channel. This is the estimated phase. This is the error which you get, so this was part of my PhD. Now, there is something which I would like to mention, and it happens all the time. You know, you are working on a subject as a PhD student, especially as a PhD student, and I can guarantee you that there will be other people working on the same subject. Okay, the probability is very, very high. So, of course, it's not exactly the same, but it's similar. Many times happens that you are working on something, you are trying to publish something, and then another paper comes out, which is similar. It happened to me, it happens to many of my students, and for this, there are two suggestions. The first one is you have to hurry to publish it, and the second is not to get disappointed, because it will not be exactly the same. It's similar, but not exactly the same, so you have to kind of change your work, or and this happened to me. I was lucky at that time. We didn't have, you know, in order to get a paper published, it took many, many years, and there was no email, nothing. So there was no available information. Now things are changed because you publish it in the archive, you submit it in the archive, and then it's there. So I don't know what is best, but anyways. Keep in mind that there will be always other people working. So don't get disappointed if something comes up, because it's very true that it might happen, okay? I went through this situation, but I was able to publish it at a conference paper and then at a journal paper. My professor, Professor Feher, he insisted for us to do some experiments. And I was also an experimental person. I used to work for Raytheon Canada Limited before my PhD. So I was interested in building things. So, and at that time, software was not there. We didn't have any software, very limited amount of software. So we had to build things by hand. So we used hardware. I know now this is not done, but there will be always hardware need. So I will show you some nice experimental data. This is what I have implemented. Took me about a year of work to do that. And I had another Japanese colleague helping me, Mr. Onishi, who was really helpful, and he had experience in this field. And these are the some eye diagrams. I will not go into the details. And this is the lab, the communication lab of Professor Feher. These are all the equipments I used. And this is my monster here. My modem was that big. So I had the cards coming in and out. As I told you, it took me about a year to do that and make it work. And I remember it wasn't working. And then something was wrong. And then Mr. Onishi came one night in the lab. And he changed. what happened was that the data I was receiving was opposite. So everything was it was correct, but since it was opposite, everything was in error. So he changed a cable, and everything worked. So it was quite an experience. So this was not for fading channels. This was for fixed channels. So now, after finishing my PhD, or during the when I was finishing my PhD, there was another friend of mine and colleague, Professor Dimitris Makrakis, and we started. We didn't have anything better to do, so we continued to do research. In Ottawa, it's cold, so you stay inside and you work. So we started working on the fading channels. At that time, there was nothing known, okay, nothing. There were no papers, no books, nothing. It was 1988. We started working on the problem, how to design the optimal receiver for these channels. It was Dimitris Makrakis's ideas. I got involved with him, and I put a lot of effort also myself. And we started working on this. And this has become perhaps the most important piece of work of mine. We proposed a receiver which was minimizing the minimum mean square error. It was the derivation was very, very general. It included any type of signals. And we assumed that the signal we will track not only the amplitude, which was at that time only the amplitude, but also the phase. Okay, we were the first ones to track the phase, and these are the some of our publications. We published it first in San Francisco at VTC in May of 1989. Then in November, and then eventually we published in the Transactions on Communication in January in 94. It took us 4 years to publish this paper because of the delays. At that time, it was mail, regular mail, no electronic submission. So we were waiting for many, many months and maybe years to get an answer. And sometimes the mail, regular mail, was lost. So it was, you are lucky in that sense. You know exactly what is happening. We had to wait. I remember also Professor Sasase, for his first paper, he told me he was waiting here in Keio University to receive the decision letter from the editor. So it was difficult times, very time-consuming times at that time. Maybe I will not go. This is as I told you, the what we propose is very general. This is the transmitter structure, and this is the fading model. This is the so-called Rayleigh fading. It consists of two. Basically, it's a Gaussian-generated fading process. Okay, so the signal is Gaussian, basically. It has Gaussian characteristics. I will not go into the details. And this is the receiver. We proposed a very general receiver, which includes many antennas, and which is shown here. And this is the receiver to be derived, and I will talk about the receiver now. Now, this obviously there is a lot of math because it's an optimal receiver, and this is from our paper in the Transactions on Communication 94. Every good paper or every important paper and any paper always boils down to a simple idea. Please remember that also. Even this applies to your PhD. If you can't explain in simple words to a knowledgeable person what is your contribution, then it's not clear your contribution, okay? Please remember that. It's all the ideas, you start with a simple idea and then you build up on this idea, okay? So our idea here is the following. There is a theorem which is well known. It's the linear prediction theorem, which tells us the following. If you have a Gaussian process and you take L samples you take N samples, then you can predict the next sample, the N plus one, by using this minimum with a minimum mean square error criterion. Okay, so in that sense, what we did is we taking the samples of the signal, which are faded signals, we took n samples and then we predicted the next one. So by predicting the amount of fading you get, you can subtract it from the signal. So this is the main idea, and upon this we derived a very complicated receiver, which is complicated in theory, but it can be implemented, and we implemented it. Okay. So now this receiver, I will not go maybe into the details, the structure of this receiver, consists of a bank of what we call multiple differential detectors. So here we don't need any carrier recovery. The carrier recovery is done from the signal itself with the receiver we have proposed. So here, for example, let's assume we have a block of m different signals. Samples of the signal, then the optimal receiver turns out to be this bank of multiple differential detectors. So we take the signal, we multiply it with a delayed version of the signal, and then we get a signal here with a 2T MT. T is the duration of the signal, of the symbol we are transmitting. So if we have, for example, a block of 1,000 symbols, then we need 1,000 of these multiple differential detectors. So it's obviously very complicated, but this is the theoretical part, okay? So if you do that, then you get the best performance, and I will talk about the performance. Now, obviously, as I say, this is too complicated, because you can have a block length of maybe 10,000 symbols or a million symbols, so you cannot have a million of these differential detectors. So we looked into the possibility of proposing reduced complexity non-optimal receivers. And so what we did is, instead of taking all the blocks, all the symbols, we take only a few of them. And it turned out, and we did the analysis here, and it turns out from computer simulations, which I will show in a minute, that you don't need all the symbols, you need just a few of them. So you need maybe three or four, and then these three or four go with the next part of the symbol, of the block. So in that sense, the complexity reduces dramatically, and as you will see, the performance loss we have is very limited. These are some state space diagrams. By the way, this is also the first time we proposed non-coherent detection of QAM signals, or multi-level signals. In the past, at that time, QAM signals were only coherently detected. Okay, so these are the multi-level signals, as you can see here. We have one circle here and another circle here. Now, this is at that time, we did have also a PowerPoint presentation, so we had like view graphs. And this I kept because it was one of the first results we got. This is again bit error rate, this is signal noise ratio. If you put, for example, a Viterbi decoder into the fading channel, it doesn't work because the Viterbi decoder is designed for a channel which is additive. I forgot to mention that the fading is a multiplicative interference. So that's the big difference between additive white Gaussian noise and fading. So fading, it multiplies the signal, so that's why the signal goes up and down. Okay, it follows the fading characteristics. Now with our receivers, with our receivers, as you can see here, the error floor is gone. Okay, these are our receivers here with Rayleigh fading. And you can see one curve here, and then there are two curves here. It's not very clear, but it's two curves here. And these are the different lengths, they are suboptimal receivers, because we didn't take all the symbols into account. We took only up to three, and we got all the gain we get, okay? There was no further improvement. So. Indeed, our receivers were suboptimal, but we didn't lose much. In fact, very little. Okay, so and then we have many, many other results, like for multi-level signals with filtered signals, and so on. Also, another thing which we did, and I should mention that in general, like when you have, for example, a channel estimation. You have always to ask yourself, how about if the channel estimation is not accurate? So if it's not accurate, then you have reduced performance, and usually you should try to find that. And we try to investigate how sensitive our receivers are to this non-exactly known channel characteristics, okay? And we did that also here. I will go through it. And then again, we built this, but this time there was a student of mine who built it at the University of British Columbia, my first PhD student who was involved with this project. And this is RF stuff, and this is the block diagram of what he implemented. It was hardware, but the novelty, the difference from my time as a PhD student was that he used a DSP processor. Okay, so the receiver was done in by means of DSP, whereas I had to do it by hardware, okay, completely hardware. So that was the novelty, the difference. Again, we got eye diagrams, and these are the spectra of the signal. This is from a spectrum analyzer. I don't know if I have used one so far, but spectrum analyzer, we see it's an expensive equipment to measure the spectrum of the signals. And this is the fading process, actually. And the results were very good, in the sense that here we got simulations, and the dots are experimental results. So they were very, very, very accurate. And this is from our lab at the University of British Columbia at that time. This was the receiver was the here, it's a DSP, and at that time very very advanced DSP, but now it's obsolete, obviously. And this was the RF part, the modulators, the modulators. We have built a fading simulator, so a lot of things to build. Dimitris Bouras did that, actually, not me. And now comes another part of my path towards the fading channels. As I told you, our derivation was very general, and but at the same time, there were some important people working on the same subject, and they published a paper after our paper, after our conference paper. And that paper is it's listed here. Difsalar and Simon, multiple simple differential detector of PSK signals. And this was done for just the additive white Gaussian noise. We had it done for the additive white Gaussian noise and the fading. So it's a lot more work. But at that time, I guess nobody knew us. There was no exchange of information. So somehow they managed to publish their paper in within 8 months, whereas it actually took 4 years. So anyways, this paper has been recognized, has received a lot of citations. It was recognized as one of the most influential papers in the 50 years of the CompSoc history, but our paper much more general, so we were disappointed about it. But about 10 years after that, there was a special issue, a JSAC, on differential and non-coherent wireless communications. And in the editorial of the editors of this journal, they recognized the importance of our work, also our work. For example, they said many improvements to the traditional schemes have been proposed over the years, but only in the mid and late 1980s, a real breakthrough in this field occurred when systematic techniques were introduced to bridge the performance gap between coherent differential detection. A first approach was based on the decision feedback techniques for improving the quality of phase reference computed on a basis of a sliding block of previous signal observations. A second solution was based on maximum likelihood detection on a block-by-block basis, and is widely known as multiple differential detection. This is our own term. Dipsala and Simon used multiple symbol differential detector. Multiple differential detector is a more general term, so the editors, they recognized our term. And these references 3 and 4 are our own, it's Dipsalar and Simon and our paper also. And I should add here that this our work has been also judged as seminal work, which is very, very, very important work, and you don't write it very easily, okay, as in an editorial, in the transactions, in an IEEE journal. Anyways, this is so what is the message, my message to the students? Looking at my experience, don't be afraid of starting something which is unknown, okay? You have to like what you are doing, that's important. Your professor is secondary. You are the driving force for your PhD because you have to prove that you are original, you have original thought. But don't be afraid of something, of starting something new. And remember always that the longest trip starts with but a simple step forward. That was said by Lao Tzu in about 600 BC, so about 2,600 years ago. And it's absolutely true. And it's the trip you enjoy. The research has up and downs always, maybe a lot of downs, but at the end, if you are persistent and you are dedicated to your work and with some help from your professor, from your colleagues also, the students, then you go up. Usually there is a progress here, time for the PhDs like that. And then somewhere, after usually at least a year, maybe 2 years, the curve goes up like an aeroplane. It takes off, okay? And this is always happening, and this is will be always happening, I think, at least in our field. I don't know in other fields, but this is a general observation. So don't get disappointed. I think that's the trick, okay? I don't know how we have okay time. So this this concludes the past work, the past history of me, and in terms of research. Now I will be moving to a kind of the work which we did at in Greece when I moved to Greece, and that was with diversity schemes in the viable fading channels. Okay. First, I will be talking about the diversity techniques. In general, the diversity techniques improve the performance. That's a very efficient, a very nice way to improve the performance, because all you need is one extra antenna, or two or three, and then you have a much better signal, the receiver is similar to what you have, basically. Okay, and there are different ways of combining, basically it's a signal combination technique. So there are different ways of combining the signal. For example, there is space diversity, there is polarization diversity, there is time diversity, time diversity and frequency diversity, for example. Okay. There are several diversity schemes. Not all are listed here, but these are the most important ones. It's the so-called the MRC, the maximal ratio combining. There is the equal gaining combining, there is the selection combining, and there is the switch and stay combining. All these techniques have advantages and disadvantages. I will be talking a little bit about them. For example, before I do that, there are some basic assumptions which we make. For example, we assume that we have perfect synchronization, perfect oscillators, slow fading, and perfect knowledge of fading phase and power delay profile of the scheme. These are some assumptions which we make, but in more advanced research, we assume that we don't make these assumptions. So we kind of propose techniques which improve the performance under more realistic conditions, operating conditions. Okay, so that under those, these are not known. So this is how we combine the signal in general. We have L different tabs, and this is how we combine the signal. So the maximum, the maximal ratio combining is it's the best receiver in the sense that it gives the best signal to noise, the best signal noise ratio at the output. But it has the highest complexity because it requires knowledge of the signal noise ratio in each of these branches. Okay. The other receiver is the so-called the equal gaining combining, where we combine the signal with an equal gain. So obviously this is less, it's not as, the performance is not as optimal as the previous one, but it's simpler. We don't need to estimate the signal noise ratio at each channel to have the same signal noise ratio, okay? So it's simpler. And the third one is the select combining, and these are and these are a little bit the philosophy is different. We have different antennas again, but we don't combine the signal of many antennas. We just select the best possible antenna. Now, what we define by best, it depends on the algorithm which we implement. For example, we can select the best signal noise ratio. That's possibility number one. Or we can set a threshold and say, if we get the threshold, we check all the antennas, and if we get this threshold, we stop, okay? Or we can say, if we don't get this threshold, then we choose one randomly. And there are different variations of this select combining. Selection combining, and this is the selective selection combining, where we select only a few, only one with certain switching threshold. Okay. So next, I will be talking about the viable fading channels. So for that, this is Professor Weibull. It's always nice, I think, to see the faces also of the persons who discovered it. Somehow, I think it shows the personality of the people. He was a professor in Sweden. And he proposed this distribution. It's the so-called the bathtub curve. It's known as the bathtub curve. I learned about this curve in Vancouver when I was buying a fax. I wanted to have a fax, so a long time ago, almost before the internet. And I went to a store, And the salesman told me he wanted to sell me some insurance about the operation of the fax machine. He tried to convince me why I should get an insurance. He didn't know that I was a professor, so I just listened. And he said, "Do you know the bathtub effect?" I said, "No, I don't." Well, he says he drove me in this bathtub. He didn't say variable distribution. I learned it afterwards. But he said the bathtub curve. He says, "Look, this is time. This is probability of failure. So the probability of failure is high when you buy the equipment, any equipment, or when it's towards the end of the life of the equipment." And I think in general this is correct. So if it works from the beginning, then it will last, but sometimes it fails from the beginning. Maybe nowadays things have changed, but certainly I think this is a correct experimental observation, okay, we make. So this is the bathtub effect. I liked it, so I bought the insurance. So he convinced me. My fax worked, so it worked until the end. So, but anyway, so it's, this is how I learned. And interestingly enough, after about 15 years, I learned that it was the Bible, and I was working on this subject. So first it started, as I say, a reliability, and just to make a parenthesis, I read the original paper of Weibull, and in those days the reviewers were in a conference. So he presented a paper, and at that time there was the procedure that the audience asked questions and comment on the paper, and that was written on the journal. And the people said this is a very important distribution. They realized at that time, and they asked him questions, and it's written actually in his original paper, the comments and his replies. So that was very interesting. And I think it's maybe they say the people who asked the questions also. So it was an open. Open source information, I guess. So before Weibull, most of the studies were done. They were done in as I say, Rayleigh, Riesian, Nakagami fading channel. But there were experimental results showing that the Weibull distribution has experimental values, especially for indoor applications, were the first ones to show this. And then for indoor and outdoor applications, and these are some references where they justify that this can be used. So from our point of view, we were interested in that. So we started working. We have a lot. We have my students now, not so much shy anymore. We are good in math. By the way, my last name is Mathiopoulos, and and Mr. Onishi, I think Onishi said that, this Japanese person who was at the University of Ottawa, he said, "You must know a lot of math," he said, because my name is Mathiopoulos. So he was, he was a typical Japanese person, and I learned a lot from him about the culture. Professor Sasa says he was very adaptive in the environment. He was not adaptive, so he was a strict Japanese. But we learned a lot from him. I learned a lot of him, from him. Here things are a little bit more complicated because we begin to deal with complicated integrals to evaluate the performance. So the tool here is to get Mayer function, and so this is a tabulated function which is known in the mathematics, and it's once you begin to deal with it, it becomes easy. But it's not from the beginning; it's not that easy, and we derived many analytical results for the performance evaluation of these receivers, For example, we found the first order statistics, the outage probability, the average bit error probability, the average sun capacity, and the second order statistics. And then also, remember in the viable distribution, I mentioned to you that there is this beta coefficient, which shows the ratio between the direct path and the reflected path. And we were curious to see how we can correlate that with the Riccian fading sun. And there is a correlation between them, between the K factor of the Riccian fading sun and the beta function. So anyways, we obtained many, many results about the average bit error probability, average xenon capacity, as I told you, the average level crossing, the average fading duration, and so on. These are analytical results, okay, which is not easy to get. And then we went into the diversity schemes. These results, which I mentioned before, are for just one receiver, one antenna. And then we went into diversity. We obtained many, many results there also. These are for another problem, which is I didn't mention in the diversity receiver, is the so-called the correlation between the signals. When two antennas are close to each other, then the signal they get is correlated. Now, this is not good, but sometimes we can't avoid that because we don't have enough space to put them very far away. So the analysis with correlation is much more difficult than without correlation, okay? So we included this in our approach, in our analysis. Now, by the way, all these are different papers, not just one paper. There are different papers. I don't mention them here, but they are different works. So this is for the EGC, the equal gain combining receivers. Then we have here, again, the similar metrics, the average output signal resistance, the amount of fading, and these are the different diversity branches. So here we have two antennas and five antennas. The higher this, the better the amount of fading is less. And this is for different normalized switching thresholds. Then we went to deal with MRC receivers and the AGC receivers. These are more difficult to deal with, okay? Mathematically, these are the most difficult one. The most difficult one is the AGC, because we have this, we have to find the, to adjust the signal noise ratio that all, so that all the signal noise ratios at all branches are the same. So now here we use the so-called PADE approximation and simulations. So these are mathematical tools. I will not go into the details. Maybe what I will mention is there is a so-called an approach, which is the MGF, the moment generated function. This is again another mathematical tool which we use to evaluate the performance. And we got again many, many results here for the for both of these schemes. We investigated them, and obviously the EGC performs better, but not significantly better than the other one. So sometimes it's better to just use MRC, which is MRC performs better than EGC. But you can see, for example, here the difference is not much. So you might well use the maximum ratio the equal gain in combining, so that you don't have to know the channel, basically. Again, here many simulation results. Now, in terms of future research topics, there are many. We are still working on the so-called the generalized fading channels. There are more complicated channels, as I mentioned before, the composite fading channels, and we are working on these, and other people, of course. Another topic is cooperative diversity with multi-hop systems. where you have the information going from to multi-hops. You can have also hops via the satellite and terrestrial, so that this is an important topic. Another open question is the optimal receivers for other fading channels. The work which I have done about 20 years ago is only for Rhesian and Rayleigh fading channel. A big question is whether, for example, we can get the optimal receivers for the Nakagami fading channel. This is an unknown problem, and it's very fundamental, I think. I always wanted to work on it, but I don't have the time. Another very active area, important area, is the massive MIMO. MIMO is basically systems which transmit with many antennas and have many receiving antennas. Massive MIMO are systems which have maybe 500 antennas, so many, many antennas. And the channel there is different, the techniques are different. And nowadays there is a lot of work on massive millimeter wave. So when the carrier frequency is like 60 gigahertz. So these are very active, very hot research areas. And also important is the aeronautical satellite communication. This is also, again, quite important topic nowadays. Now I close with some kind of personal facts and some important milestones and some important information. Well, I think the first conference I attended, the first major IEEE conference I attended to present a paper, was about 30 years ago here in Tokyo at Globcom in 1987. It was the first time that Globcom was organized to be outside of North America, and it was a big event. It was there were a lot of issues. For example, you know, the Americans, they are not easy to go outside at that time, to go outside of North America. It was expensive. It was very competitive, though. Many people wanted to come here, and I remember it was a very big competition for this conference. I was lucky enough to have a paper accepted, so for me, I had the opportunity to come here. And I was, this conference, I think, influenced my life, both personally and professionally. Professionally, because I had the first paper accepted, I met all these important people. And in fact, also I got an award. That award was not on paper, but it was on money. They gave me $500. It was the first time they gave to students. If you had a paper accepted and the first author was a student, you got this award to come over here because it was expensive, right? At that time, though, $500 was a huge amount of money for me. I think I had a budget of maybe $1,500, and Professor Sasase helped me with finding a good and cheap hotel, a Japanese hotel, because at that time the conference was held at Keio Plaza, because I remember about $200 at that time per night. We didn't stay there. And at that time, also, Keio Plaza Hotel was the tallest building in the area, the only tallest building. Now things have changed. I was there with Hiromu last time, and I was stunned. I mean, I saw the Keio Plaza Hotel, and it was small compared to the other buildings you have there. So, anyways, that was I was introduced to the Japanese way of life, and it was a great experience for me. Honestly, a great experience. And recently, I attended Globcom 2017 in Singapore, where I was given the award for outstanding contributions in satellite communication. This is a big, it's not the biggest award, it's an important award, and I'm very proud to be the first Greek to get this award. Since they gave this award since 1985, and Professor Sasa, well, even before 82, I think, or something. And Professor Sasa knows about it because he was the chairman of the committee who gave me, he was the chairman, he was not involved with my award, but he was the chairman of the Satellite Space Communication Committee for 2 years at the beginning of the 90s, I believe. So I was, and I was elected, by the way, between 5 nominees. So it's it was tough. So when I heard that, that I was say, well, not disappointed, but I say, well, we'll see. But I got it. So I was very, very happy. And I gave a speech, which I called my trip to Singapore. And I started my speech by saying my trip to Singapore started with yet another trip to Tokyo, Japan, attending Globcom 87. And I mean that, it was 30 years ago where I started, and I attended the first satellite space communication meeting, maybe. As I told you, it influenced my professional and personal life in so many ways. I dedicated this to my late mother, Martha, for transferring me her need for education and progress. And I accepted this as a professor of University of Athens as my main affiliation, but also as a guest professor in Keio. I mentioned this in my speech. And these are some pictures. you can guess, this is not now. This is at Globcom. The only picture I found, actually. I have other pictures, but I don't know where they are. They are hidden somewhere, and I didn't have time to find them. So this is Dr. Uenohara, I believe was his name, if I remember correctly. He was the VP, he was with NEC, correct? I remember his name, I haven't met him since that time. He was the VP for Student Affairs, I think. And he didn't give me an award, but he gave gave me a check of $500. And as I told you, I felt a huge amount of money. And it was. And this time they didn't give me any money, but they gave me this this award, so which is better, I think. And this is with my daughter. She came with my wife, and we had some sightseeing. And for her, we stayed at the Marina Bay Hotel for a few days, not the whole duration, which has this very nice swimming pool. And she loved the hotel. She didn't want to leave because we left because it was too expensive, but the first few days we stayed there. And as you can see, she was, she didn't, I don't know whether she cared very much about the award, but she wanted after that to go to the swimming pool. So her mother brought her a dress, but she didn't want to wear it. So she wanted to go to the swimming pool directly afterwards. So so that was it. And finally, I show you some pictures, nice pictures from my home country, Greece. I always do that with important presentations. This is one of my favorite beaches. There are no people there. You can relax and enjoy the scenery. It's on an island. I call it, I call it the I University of Serifos, which doesn't exist. Serifos is a small island in the middle of the Aegean, and we go there every summer. And this place, this beach called is called Sikamia, so it's I call it the I campus, like which does not exist, of course, but I say that as a joke. But it's very beautiful. It's this usually we stay under one of these trees, and we enjoy the sea and the and this is the sunset. This this view is from this tree from here somewhere, and this is this place. The sun goes down here in the summer. In the winter it goes down here. So this is very beautiful, and Greece is a beautiful country, especially with the water, and I hope one day you can visit us. Professor Sasase comes often, and many of his students now come, and not only we have a good academic time, but we have also a good time around sometimes. With that, I think I'm almost done. Yeah, the Seriphos is somewhere in the middle here. Is in the area of Cyclades. It's this island here. It's this island here. And with acknowledgements, I would like to thank my collaborators with whom I did all this work I described. I would like to thank Keio University for giving me the opportunity to come here, and Professor Sasase for his friendship and for allowing me to pass my PhD exam long time ago. And I think, thank you. This is in Greek. We call it ευχαριστώ. It's like math, but this is what we mean, ευχαριστώ.
I want to ask you some questions from the front of the floor.
Thank you for the presentation. I was just wondering if there is any comparison between your proposed like multiple differential detector and like more recent detectors or.
Actually, this is an interesting question. There have been works on this topic, but they are limited. For example, there have been improvements for some with coding schemes, but the work is a little bit limited. The more general question about the optimal receiver for example, MIMO systems, it's open. So this is a really important topic. I don't know if we can find the answer, but this is something which is open. This topic has a little bit stopped. It has progressed a little bit, but not significantly. So it remained in the, in simplified channels, basically, in now simplified. At that time, it wasn't. So it's an open problem. I don't know if it's solvable, but certainly my feeling it is that it is. It is. Okay.
Okay, sir. Another questions?
Okay. Thank you very much for the lecture. What is the good point or difficult point of dealing the fading with Weibull distribution? What is a good point and the difficult point of dealing the fading with Weibull distribution?
The difficult point is that it's difficult mathematically, okay, to deal with it. That was the main difficulty. We started out of curiosity to obtain analytical results. So the difficulty we had was that it's difficult analytically to deal with. So the good point is that I don't know, maybe we were able to solve it, these problems. Perhaps another step would be to try to get experimental results. We haven't done that because when I did this at the National Observatory of Athens, we had no equipment. I started this wireless research from zero, and I didn't have any funding for equipment. So although I like labs, I mean, in terms of hardware, but maybe experimental results will be interesting to have.
Yeah. Okay, so any other questions? Okay, one question I was asking you. Since there's many PhD or master students, so you can give them some suggestions. Or you give us some of the suggestions. Yes. And also, my comment is that maybe when we are working together, at that time, professor asked us, we have to do some research with two ways. One is the theory, or experiment, or simulations. Yeah. Not only of them. I think now most of students are doing some simulations, but I don't think that is not good. Because a simulation can make any kind of result. And we are not sure whether this is really good, right or not, something like that. So you can give them some questions.
Actually, I don't remember if I mentioned that, but I wanted to mention that. It's three items, analysis or theory, simulations and hardware, and experiments, basically, not necessarily hardware. In order for you to get your PhD, which means in order for you to publish a paper, because you have to publish a paper to get a PhD, then you need at least two of these. So nowadays, experiments, I must admit, it's difficult. You have to have the facility. Some labs, they have the facilities. Typically, these labs are doing, they have big projects and they can buy equipment. Now, if you don't have equipment, you have to think of good simulations, but they have to be checked by analysis. Usually, these two, but both are important. Okay, for you to get paper published, then you need to have this at least these two. It's very important. And also, by the way, I'm here also. To get involved and to give you advice with topics you are working on. This is one area I'm interested in, but the last few years I have been working in other areas. For example, here we have been working with Dr. Toyota on blockchain. He has been working on that, and I learned also from him, and we have done some really good work, in other areas. I'm involved with different students. So the good thing about me, I think, that I have experience in understanding how to complete research. So I'm here to help you, and to please take advantage of me to ask questions, and I will try to answer them. And my advantage is that I have a lot of experience and in that way I can help you with your research.
Okay, so any other questions? It's okay. I just said that he will stay one more week, until February 4th.
Next Sunday, not this Sunday, the next one.
So if you have any question, you have to discuss.
Please send me an email, and I have an office. They give me kindly an office on the 7th floor.
Yeah.
So, but send me an email and we can make an appointment so that because I don't come here all the time.
Yeah.
But I'm here also. This is I forgot to mention. Thanks for mentioning that to me. I'm here to help you as much as I can.
Okay. So. Thank you very much.
Yeah, my pleasure. Arigato.
Much.